Begin your examination by introducing yourself to the patient, gaining consent, and washing your hands. Stand at the end of the patient's bed to assess their overall condition. Look for clues around the bed, such as sputum pots, inhalers, oxygen delivery systems, nebulizers, non-invasive ventilation, infusions such as theophylline or antibiotics, and any walking aids. All of these things can help build a picture of the severity of the patient's respiratory illness and their level of frailty. Now focus on the patient themselves. Observe their general appearance and consider, do they look unwell? Next, move on to the peripheral examination. Check the hands for signs of peripheral cyanosis, which indicates deoxygenated blood in the peripheral circulation. Tar staining from smoking. Palmar erythema, which is suggestive of CO2 retention, found in chronic obstructive pulmonary disease. Next, look for loss of nail bed angle, which indicates finger clubbing. Use the Shamroff window test by asking the patient to bring their fingers together so that the nails of the index fingers touch one another. Under normal circumstances, a small diamond-shaped window should be present. In finger clubbing, the window is absent. Note that there are many causes of finger clubbing, but it can indicate lung cancer, bronchiectasis, lung abscess, and hypersensitivity pneumonitis. Look for tremors. The fine tremor associated with beta-2 agonists and the asterixis flapping tremor of CO2 retention. Assess the respiratory rate and palpate the radial pulse to assess rate and rhythm. Next, move on to examine the jugular venous pressure. If the JVP is elevated, this may suggest right heart failure, which is common in respiratory diseases such as chronic obstructive pulmonary disease and pulmonary embolism. If you are unable to see the JVP, elicit the hepatojugular reflex. Next, move on to facial examination. Look at the eyes for signs of Horner syndrome, which is caused by an apical lung tumour. Horner syndrome presents with a partial ptosis, which is a drooping of the upper eyelid, meiosis, which is constriction of the pupil, and facial anhydrosis, which is the absence of sweating of the skin. Check for pallor of the mucous membranes, which is suggestive of anemia, and look for central cyanosis of the lips and tongue, which is indicative of deoxygenated blood in the central circulation. With the patient sitting forward, feel the lymph nodes for any enlargement. With the pulse of your fingers and using small circular rotation, palpate the submental, submandibular, anterior cervical, posterior cervical, preauricular, auricular, posterior, and occipital nodes. Also palpate the supraclavicular nodes bilaterally. Lymph nodes in these areas are significant if they are greater than 1 cm in size. Raised lymph nodes may indicate a normal inflammatory process, bacterial or viral infections, and malignancy. Next, move on to thoracic examination. Begin by observing the chest for scars such as thoracotomy scars, and for chest wall deformities such as pectus excavatum, pectus carinatum, and barrel chest. Palpate the trachea for deviation, as this may indicate mediastinal shift, which is seen in lung collapse, large pleural effusions, and tension pneumothorax. Check the location of the apex beat and assess chest wall expansion. Place your hands on the patient's chest and imagine a line drawn between your thumbs. As the chest wall expands during inspiration, the distance between the thumbs and the line should remain roughly equal. Chest expansion will be reduced on one side in pleural effusion and pneumothorax. Test for tactile fremitus by placing your hand on the patient's chest and have them repeat the word 99 continuously. Vibrations generated by the patient's speech will be transmitted to your hand, but these vibrations will be more palpable over areas of consolidation and less so over areas of pneumothorax, collapse, and pleural effusion. Perform percussion to assess resonance. Percussion is performed by placing your hand on the patient's chest and then striking the mid-phalanx of the finger. The density of the tissue below determines the resonance of the percussion sound. Note the different percussion sounds and their possible causes. Finally, auscultate breath sounds and listen for any added sounds. Auscultate the chest in the following anatomical areas. Begin at the apices and move down the thorax as you proceed. Repeat the same examination on the patient's posterior thorax. Inspect the patient's posterior thorax. Look for abnormalities of the spine such as scoliosis and kyphosis. Both of these spinal abnormalities can have a significant effect on chest wall movement. Palpate the thorax, performing chest expansion. Tactile fremitus and percussion. End with auscultation. Auscultate the chest in the following anatomical areas. Begin at the apices and move down the thorax as you proceed. Complete the examination by looking at the lower limbs. Check for evidence of pitting edema, which may indicate right heart failure secondary to respiratory disease, and look for calf swelling, which might indicate deep vein thrombosis. This could lead to a pulmonary embolism. You may choose to complete the examination with additional tests such as a peak flow test or spirometry, taking the patient's temperature and oxygen saturations. Imaging of the chest and blood work may also be beneficial. This brings us to the end of today's episode. If you haven't already, please like, subscribe, and hit the bell so that you are notified when more great content like this is released. I'll see you in the next show.